strangers, whether I would trust one and whether I would help one. And he persuades me to make a commitment to support a real stranger for a year. I do this by firstly sending a postcard through the mail, then corresponding online, and finally, weeks later, meeting this person face to face. What began as an afternoon's art game evolves into a year-long encounter with someone. It's a typical example of the great vision and originality of Matt Adams' work. He's a true pioneer and original, doing genuinely new things and establishing unprecedented artistic paradigms. The great avant-garde composer John Cage once said that the purpose of art is, quote, not to bring order out of chaos, nor to suggest improvements in creation, but simply to wake us up to the very life we are living. Matt Adams is a perfect example of such an artist. His projects engage deeply with the lives we are living, including the changes in our lives brought about by new technologies. And like our lives, Matt's works are intimately concerned with the social, the personal, and the political. He also wakes us up, sometimes with a real shock and a jolt, and always in ways that open our eyes to new worlds and ideas and to illuminating truths and insights about what Cage calls the very life we are living. Ladies and gentlemen, will you please give a very warm welcome to Matt Adams.
Hello. It's a great start, that's one. Thank you, Steve, for that very generous introduction. It's a great pleasure and an honour to be here with you tonight. And there will be questions, a chance to ask questions at the end, and I look forward very much to having a conversation with you at that stage. This is a picture of our studio. We're based in Brighton in the UK. And as Steve mentioned, Jew, Rofar, and Nick Tandevanich and I collaborate together. And the version of our work that I'm going to give you tonight would be very different if it was Jew or Nick standing here. One of the things that makes the collaboration that we have together so enduring, I think, is that we're very different people with very different perspectives. And our work is as much an argument as it is an agreement, but hopefully it's a kind of productive one. And I also wanted to sort of mention at the outset that we collaborate with the Mixed Reality Lab at the University of Nottingham and have done since the late 1990s. It's been about 20 years now, and that's a very rich and important part of the work that we've made. And many of the projects I'm going to share with you are collaborations with the MRL directly, and many of the rest of them are informed by the dialogue we've had with them over that period of time. All the work I'm going to show you is interactive. And Brian Eno, the musician, said a really nice thing about interactive work. It's unfinished. And I think that's a really important way of thinking about interactivity, that it leaves something open for the visitor, the participant, the interactor, the viewer, the visitor, the audience member to come and engage with and complete for themselves. And that's especially important in terms of how I'm showing the work, in that it sort of it's tidied up into a narrative that I can present to you, but there are many individual and highly personal experiences that take place within the works, such as Steve's description of Uncle Royal around you, that you have to sort of bear in mind as we go through these things. I wanted to give a brief history of Blast Theory. I know that's when someone's been making work for 25 years and they start a lecture like that, that's normally time for your heart to sink, but hopefully I will skip over enough parts and stick to some of the interesting bits. The first works we made, this is the very first show we ever made, but a series of the first works we made were all influenced by club culture in the UK, and we drew heavily on what was happening in club culture in the late 1980s and early 1990s, and to create our own events, often in found spaces like film studios or disused buildings, working with DJs, putting on events in which our promenade performances were part of a club night, But they all started with a very direct call on the audience to interact and to be part of it. My background is in theatre. I fell in love with theatre as a sort of 12 or a 13-year-old. And as I got more and more interested in the art form of theatre, I couldn't really understand why theatre in the age of cinema and television and other electronic media still had rows of seats and had performances where the performers stood on the stage and more or less the same thing happened every single night. It seemed to me that if theatre is to survive, then the very liveness, that amazing energy and charge of theatrical performance has to be the activating principle of the art form. And Jew and Nick, neither of whom come from theatre or could really care anything about theatre, came from different perspectives but with the same kind of impetus, which is how can we create something where there is an urgency that compels you as an audience to be involved? And this is as good an example as any from those early works, where in Gunmen Kill 3, a work around killing and about the act of taking life, we invited a member of the audience who had never fired a gun before to volunteer to fire a gun for the first time, and then gave them a paintball gun and explained the kind of wound a paintball will give someone with exposed flesh from a distance of 5 meters, and then invited them, if they chose to fire the gun at the two performers that you can see there. So it's a kind of classic early shock tactic in one sense, but it also perhaps sets our stall out in terms of the kinds of strategies that we were looking to employ, where you would go away as much having feeling that you had witnessed something as that you had been at a show or an art event. And this moment in the show, we always made it clear that if they didn't fire, that was fine. We would just move on with the show. And as you can imagine, very strong feelings were aroused by that section. Strong arguments would take place in the among the audience. Having explored these kinds of questions over a number of different works, in 1998 we came to the work Kidnap that Steve just mentioned. And we were interested in exploring how power is manifested and how it flows between people, and why we so often give up power in ways that seem very interesting to us. You know, we live in a culture where the idea that we're in self-control, that we have our own lives to live, that we orchestrate our lives according to our own principles and values, why there were so many places where we give up power to others. We do that politically by voting every now and then letting the politicians deal with it. Other people do it by taking drugs, where you put something into your body and you're not fully in control of yourself. You don't fully know what you have signed up for. People do it through religious experience. There are so many different areas where we happily let go of things and hand over control. And this room is a great example of it, where you've come in with some degree of contract with me that you'll sit over there and be quiet and let me stand up here and be noisy. That's an act of willing sacrifice of control. We tried to make a piece of theatre out of it. We tried to make a performance, and for a long time could not find a satisfying way of addressing this question. And then out of that process came this sudden moment of an idea, which is, okay, why not invite people to give up the ultimate form of control to us? We will invite the members of the public to pay to enter a lottery in which the first and the second prize is to be kidnapped by us. And there were a couple of important things about culture in the UK at the time that you should know that sort of informed the work. One is the National Lottery had recently been introduced, which was a government's lottery to raise money for good causes. And we were in a very febrile and overexcited atmosphere about instant millionaires being created every week. And in those days, there was a lot of coverage of that. And the second thing was we were in the aftermath of a little-known but highly significant trial called the Spanner Trial. The Spanner Trial was created when the police got hold of some VHS cassettes of gay sadomasochistic acts. And what they had discovered was a small group of gay men who got together for S&M and recorded what happened. The police went to prosecute these men, at which point all of the men said, well, we all know each other and we've all consented to everything that is on the tape, and therefore this isn't a matter for the police. And the police refused that and took them to court anyway. They were then convicted by a judge of actual bodily harm, and the longest sentence that the men got, one of them got sentenced for 4 years in prison. This was appealed to the European Court of Human Rights, and they upheld the decision. And so this is a key precedent under UK law, where suddenly the state was claiming the right that even though you consented to something, that was not necessarily a defense. And when we decided that we would do kidnap and got legal advice, the legal advice we had was, yeah, actually, after the Spanner trial, this is an extremely ambiguous area, and if you are prosecuted, we cannot guarantee any way how this will unfold. So we ran this lottery. We charged £10 to enter. We worked with a clothing company as a sponsor, and they put the entrance forms in their stores across the UK. And then on a pre-assigned day, we then went and kidnapped Russell and Deborah, and I've got a short film that shows what happened. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Right, stop.
Because once you put a bag on your head, it all becomes very real and you don't feel like you're in control. It's not a bit of a laugh anymore. It's sort of, well, I don't know what's going to happen.
Okay. As you see there, that was a work streamed live to the web. That was the first time that we did work online. And we released Deborah and Russell at a press conference after being held for 48 hours. And that video is very deliberate in how it's structured, where you see some of the sheer tedium of two people being locked in a room. And the work is, you know, was streamed online throughout those 48 hours, and so you have this kind of weird sort of sub Harold Pinter, sub Samuel Beckett kind of drama of total inanity at one level and total purience and voyeurism at another level. And it was certainly the first time for me that I learned how people who are watching something online can have a completely different moral framework to the people who are present in that place. At around this time, we met up with the University of Nottingham, with the Mixed Reality Lab, and we made our first piece with them. This is Desert Rain. and it's the first work we made for virtual reality. Some of you may be too young to be aware that this is at least the third moment that VR is the trendiest technology in the room. It had a little moment in the late 80s and early 1990s, and then sort of a decade later, it became a really big deal, and then it went very quiet again, and obviously it's now back in full effect, and this time it's definitely going to happen. But the VR that existed then was not head-mounted VR. Universities built huge cubes, which is essentially six-sided projection spaces into which you would go. And the University of Nottingham, made available to us the virtual reality engine that they had, and said, "Are you interested to explore this?" And we had no knowledge of VR at all up to that point. And as I delved into it, I became fascinated by the fact that there were French theorists like Jean Baudrillard talking about virtuality, but they meant it in a completely different sense. They meant in the sense of a kind of a confected and constructed realm of simulation. And this seemed like a very curious interconnection. And then as we looked further, we discovered that that virtual reality, the main application of virtual reality, of course, is for military training. And this then connects deeply with the first Gulf War of 1991, where for the first time pilots are using remote electronic and virtual tools for the deployment of munitions. So we took that kind of intersection as a starting point for a piece of work, and we made a game for six people at a time that where you go in to explore the virtual world. The virtual design tools were pretty crude, as you can see here, but that is actually three avatars floating down that corridor. So it's extremely sort of low res, something where we're working very much with the limitations of the technology. And we decided that the screen that we wanted to use was a screen of falling water spray. And I'll show you this in a minute, a little clip of this. But you really can't capture it on video, because the whole point is you have it extremely dark and then project onto it, and then the screen is kind of floating in the tiny air movements within the room, and the image is kind of glistening and catching on that water spray. So it's hard to catch at any time. It's certainly hard to catch on the cameras we had at the time. But the critical moment of that, as you will see on the video, is where each player is on a mission to find someone in a virtual desert against the clock. Another against the clock game. You've got 20 minutes to find that person and get out before time runs out. And you get so immersed in playing the game that you are completely unaware of a performer coming through the water physically right towards you. And the kind of critical moment of that work is this moment where suddenly you realize what seems to be a disruption in the field of the screen is in fact a real person who's emerged through the water in front of you. It's a game that shifts over the course of the experience to jolt you through a number of different sort of frames, if you like. It starts off as a game. Go into the virtual desert, find the person that you've been charged to find and get out, and then gradually the story shifts you where suddenly the people who you were looking for were not just artifacts within a game, but are people who are all directly connected to the Gulf War of 1991. And so the work has a documentary element where we found six people and interviewed them. And without further blather, I'll show you a little bit of video about this.
You're about to enter a virtual world, and I'm going to tell you everything you need to know to make it through the next 20 minutes. These are your targets. Keep them safe. You are player 6. You are looking for Amy. You are player 5. You are looking for Glenn. You are player 4. You are looking for Tony. You are player 3. You are looking for Richard. You are player 2. You are looking for Sam. You are player 1. You are looking for Shona. can get close to other players in the world. You can speak to them using your microphones. You have 20 minutes in which to find your targets and then work together as a group to find the exit and leave the world.
So you can see there that the interface device is a tilting pad that you move your body weight on.
The first night of the war, everybody was heaven. Saw these strikes go in very successfully. This is one of those times when I really had a sense of history. I had the battle plan on my lap, and we were sitting here watching CNN.
So at the moment that it looks like the game is over, you enter into two more spaces. This corridor filled with several tons of sand, which you have to climb over. And then you emerge into a simulacrum of a hotel room.
And, it was a 6-week shoot, and we had a week, or I suppose just over a week, of preparation. The whole army base atmosphere was created out in an airport in the middle of nowhere, at the Kalahari. So that was, it helped immediately. You know, you'd walk out there and everything looked, it looked like we'd seen it on the television. It was frightening.
CNN had spent months and months greasing the palms of the right Iraqi officials so that they would be able to broadcast that night. Now, some of my BBC colleagues found that very distasteful. They found the idea that CNN had done deals with the Iraqis to broadcast on that night wrong. But I think nowadays the BBC and all the other organizations do that routinely.
So you see there that when you arrive into that final room, you realize that the person who you were looking for all that time in the virtual desert is in fact someone directly involved in the Gulf War in some way. Sam Halpeny, who you saw there first of all, was in a major TV film about the Gulf War and played an SAS soldier. So he talks all about preparation for pretending to be an SAS soldier, going to the Kalahari Desert and enacting a famous SAS mission from the Gulf War. Eamon Matthews was the BBC producer who was in Baghdad on the night of the Gulf War. The other people you see there were soldiers, peace activists, and so on. So the work gradually shifts into this documentary space, all the time playing around with the limits of our knowledge and the kind of fuzziness of our epistemology around the Gulf War. It really plays with the category of the real, the fictional, the virtual, and the imaginary, and those four categories are constantly getting blurred across as the game unfolds, and we were very interested in how these things seem to kind of interpenetrate in bizarre and unfathomable ways, and I guess this is something sort of in the last year or two that has become even more part of our discourse, but even then, you know, tank simulation engines that were developed by the American military for the Gulf War were subsequently licensed to games designers in the early 1990s to make tank games about the Gulf War and so on. The U.S. Army has often worked with people from Hollywood and other cultural industries to bring in ideas and disciplines, techniques into military training. So you see a two-way journey all the time between warfare and the discourse around warfare. So the next work that I wanted to show is Can You See Me Now? Desert Rain toured around the world for 4 years, and it used 17 tons of equipment and toured in a large truck. And around the time that we were unloading and loading this truck over and over again and shoveling 4 tons of sand onto that ramp every night, we became aware of how mobile telephony was going to move. I went to a presentation in about the year 2000 where someone talked about something called 3G phone telephony and the idea that a phone would be connected to the internet. My mind was blown. And the combination of that seeming like such a profound transformative thing and the fact that mobile phones were really a lot smaller and required a lot less carrying around than Desert Rain's kit meant that we got very interested in trying to explore mobile technology. This is in the days when, of course, a GPS was not a thing that came on the phone. It was a piece of hardware that you bought for several hundred pounds to be able to get a GPS signal. And the university were able to buy some of those and give us some of those to play with. And we started to experiment with, okay, what can you do? In what kinds of ways might this be going to change the world around us? And what are the kind of cultural possibilities? Many of the times where we're working, say, in VR or in mobile, what we're trying to do is articulate other ways of using these technologies, articulate different kinds of possibilities. You know, people think hard about the military and they think hard about the commercial. Well, what about all the other ways in which this is going to change the world? And we are, see ourselves very much as part of an artistic community that is there to ask those questions and try and posit some answers and try and shift the needle in a tiny way, possibly, about how it might be used differently. So Can You See Me Now? Again, at this point, we've really got very, very interested in games design, and we're working a lot in games design. Desert Rain was the first time we had really made something that was properly a game. What we suddenly realized is that games are this fantastic invitation to the general public. Everyone knows how to play a game. A three-year-old girl knows how to play a game when you ask. And so suddenly there's this completely different kind of invitation. Rather than it being an experimental artwork using advanced technologies, it was, do you want to play? How do I play? Oh, well, I'll tell you. And then immediately people are into something and have a different kind of experience and relationship to it. And Can You See Me Now is sort of symptomatic of that, in that the work is not thematically structured, really. The work is structured through the nature of the relationships it engenders. It's a game played online and on the street. People who play online play in a virtual city. people who play on the street are in the actual city of which that is a virtual model. And so there is this kind of indexical relationship between the real and the virtual. In this first version, this work, Can You See Me Now?, the people on the street are us, because in those days you needed a fair amount of technical skill to be able to deal with a handheld computer and a GPS system and a Wi-Fi network. So we would set up our own Wi-Fi networks wherever we went, because Wi-Fi didn't really exist outside of very specialist areas at this stage. And I'm going to show a little bit of video of this work.
Do you want me to announce it? This is runner 6. Okay. Runner 6 です. Brass Theory. Can you see me now? ようこそ.
Can You See Me Now? Is an online game. Players log in and are dropped at a random location in a virtual city. Players move their avatar through the streets to avoid being caught by the runners, who are represented in the virtual world in red. The runners are performers on the streets of the city who are equipped with GPS receivers and PDAs with GPRS cards. The runner's speech is streamed live to the website, and online players can respond using a chat window.
I'm trying to get, Emily! Hello, Emily!
I have seen that panorama at 3 o'clock nearby park.
Congratulations, good job, good catch.
This is runner 6. I have seen my Nana.
Okay, so what might not be apparent there is that the work is playing around with absence and presence, and with proximity and distance at a number of different levels. It's a schoolyard game. It's a game of catch. So you need to stay away from someone, or when someone gets close enough to you, you are knocked out of the game. The game, of course, is linking people across the world online with these very, in this case, in Tokyo. We did this work in about 22 or 24 cities, something like that. In this version, all of those people are being brought into this tiny few set of streets in Tokyo, into this very kind of particular relationship with that. And most specifically, when you register to play the game, you're asked to name someone who you think about often but haven't seen for a long time. And when you're caught at the end, you are not referred to by your name, you're referred to by their name. So there is this calling up of this name from your past at the moment that you were caught. And sometimes that's 20 or even 30 minutes after you logged in, and it's something that's really sort of slipped out of your mind, and you have this little kind of Proustian moment of suddenly being knocked back to that thought. And then, as you see there at the end, the performers take a photo of the square of ground in which you were caught, and they upload that to the website with your name and the timestamp on it, and so you can go online and see the exact square of ground where you were seen. So the work is playing around with how the internet connects us and does not connect us, and I think this is a theme that you'll see in a number of the works tonight. We made a number of works in mixed reality. Uncle Royal Around You, as Steve mentioned and handily summarized for me to save me the time of having to do that, is a development of that where then members of the public are playing both online and on the street, and we kind of step out of that relationship and we are then orchestrating that relationship. And we became, you know, really, really fascinated in the possibilities of that. We made a piece of work in South Australia called I Like Frank, in the world's first one of the first 3G test beds in the world was installed in Adelaide, and they gave us access to that to actually do it over 3G. So we really pushed at the limits of how that might work. But gradually we reached a point where we became less interested in trying to work at the cutting edge of technology and more interested in how we might use the ubiquitous technologies that we already had. any cutting edge technology has a kind of inequality and a kind of economic slope attached to it. With VR now, you are invited to the VR party if you are willing to spend, I don't know how much it is in Singapore, in England it's a couple of £100 maybe for a headset, plus the console to run it on, et cetera, et cetera. So it isn't for everyone, it's for people who have disposable income, and so there's always this kind of weird slant around how technology is used, and we work various strategies to try and sort of deal with that problem, to loan kits so that people didn't have to own anything, and so on. But around this point, we also started to look at SMS, and we started to go, hang on, here is one technology that is in everyone's pocket already. This is the point where sort of mobile phones had reached saturation in the UK. We were like, okay, can we do something with just text messages? And Day of the Figurines is our first exploration of that. So it's a massively multiplayer game. So up to 1,000 people can play the game at once. And it's a super slow game. It takes 24 days to play. And you have to come here to start. We did actually show this here at the Singapore National Museum. To begin, you choose a figurine like this fella. We found these plastic models that are made for the German hobbyist railway scene. And the Germans take their model railways very seriously. There is a lot you can buy. And although, strangely, not a great deal of ethnic representation, diversity is not really filtered down to the German railway modeling scene. So that was always quite a challenge. We just thought, oh, it's such a nice kind of fun start point that you have a figurine to represent you within the game. It's people have a very strong emotional response to this table where we'd have 100 at a time laid out, and people would take ages choosing which one they wanted to represent them. And then you put that figurine onto the table, which is a model of a small, run-down, slightly grotty English town that bears a striking resemblance to the area of Brighton that we live in called Portslade. And you then interact in the game by sending text messages. So having put your figurine on once, you then walk away and you never need to come back to the table ever again. Everything is done by a text message. And you then use a series of commands to move around and to do activities. And over the 24 days of the game, 24 hours in the life of this town elapse. And you get little missions. For example, you might have to go to the Rat Research Institute and liberate some dogs that are being experimented on there for laboratory purposes. And so you might then need to go and find a ladder that will enable you to get over the wall into the Rat Research Institute. So it's a really simple little game mechanic of collecting things, exploring the city, and everywhere you go, you meet other players and you can chat to them. The kicker is that halfway through the game, a bunch of soldiers start turning up and putting roadblocks in place. And they only speak Arabic, and so it's no one can really understand what they're saying, but they shut the whole town down, and you enter a slightly dystopian world where order starts to unravel, and the final hours of the game are spent trying to escape as the city loses control. And obviously, this is at a time where the UK has a strong armed presence in Iraq. And it's one of many countries that we've chosen to bless with our military presence and set up roadblocks in other people's cities. And so at that time, it's an impossible to overlook the obvious resonance of Arabic-speaking soldiers turning up in a small British town and setting up roadblocks. And they're not aggressive. They have their job to do. If you mess with them, then they have guns, but they are otherwise polite and perfectly orderly. The dystopia comes from people panicking and not being sure how to deal with the situation. So it's an oblique reference of to British and American military endeavors. And once an hour at the table, we used a projection system to move every figurine to its updated position. So this board is an hourly report of who's playing and where they are, and the operators turn on this system of grids and lines to show which figurine has moved from which position. And so there's this nice kind of little performative rhythm. And so when it's in a public place, people would often pop back, sometimes every day, just to see what's happening and see where their figurine is compared to other people and so on. Day of the Figurines was also part of a sequence of works using SMS, and we made a piece of work for the broadcaster Channel 4 in the UK called Ivy Forever, which was also about interacting via SMS, but this time directly one-to-one with a character called Ivy, who treats you as if she's your best friend, and for 7 days she's messaging you backwards and forwards as she goes through a kind of pivotal moment in her life. About 4 or 5 years ago, we were approached by National Theatre Wales for a commission. They asked us to make a piece of work, and this was at a moment where we had become aware of how Facebook was handling data, or rather not really handling data, and we decided that we would make a piece of work about that, and we made a smartphone app called Karen that Steve mentioned. What's interesting is that the data breach that has been revealed in the last couple of weeks by Cambridge Analytica, I am part of that data breach, because this is exactly the moment at which I was going around Facebook looking for who is doing data gathering and psychological profiling on Facebook, and came across the app that then became part of the trawl of data that Cambridge Analytica essentially stole out of Facebook. And we decided we would make a piece of work initially to expose exactly what Facebook was doing and just how egregious some of those violations were. But they did tighten them up through 2012, 2013, and 2014. They gradually realized what the mistakes that they were making, and there were little miniature scandals that came along, often at an internet level, and they would then force Facebook to do some sort of tidying up. And so gradually we decided to make a work that had a kind of slightly wider remit, and we made a work about a life coach called Karen. And this is Karen here, played by the actor Claire Cage. So she is not a kind of virtual avatar in any way. She is very real, very tangible. The whole work is shot as a feature film. There's about 90 minutes of film inside the app. And so you are inside Karen's life over a period of days. You can only contact her when she wants to contact you. So it's not a game that you can play and binge and do it all in an hour and put it away. Once you've had a chat to her today, she says, oh, well, I'll call you tomorrow. And you then wait until she calls you tomorrow. You're very much partly at her beck and call as much as she is at yours. And she offers, as the app starts, she offers to life coach you. And she's actually quite kind of professional and formal to start with, quite smartly dressed. She's at home, but she's definitely really on top of her game. And she asks you what you've come to her for help with, and she offers to help you with your family or your relationships or your career. And she starts to ask you questions about that. As the days go on, very quickly, that professional veneer starts to break down. Even the second day that you go for her lesson, there's a dryer behind her with a large pair of men's underpants drying just behind her that she seems unaware of. And gradually you start to see that she's not really quite as professional as she's first appeared. She's perhaps not as trained as a life coach as you might hope, but she's still really chatty and she's asking you things all of the time, and you're invited to give answers. So this is the very first interaction you ever have. She says, I'm knackered, how are you? And you get to tell her how you're feeling, and it goes on from there. Before I show you a little clip of one episode, I want to just sort of take you back through the research journey that we went on. I mentioned starting with Facebook, but we also decided to look at the history of psychometric profiling, and we worked with two researchers, one from the UK and one from the US, who really did have quite a lot of knowledge about psychometric profiling and how that came about. One of them had actually worked with Google's ad tracking technology before it was acquired by Google. And we went back to find some of the origins of this, and it goes back over a century. But one of the critical moments in the development of psychometric profiling that we came across was a book called The Assessment of Men, which was published by the Office of Strategic Services. Does anyone know what the OSS became? What's that? CIA, exactly. So it's during Second World War, when they were training people to operate behind enemy lines, some people who they'd put a lot of training into completely fell apart as soon as they were put behind enemy lines. And it became an immediate priority after World War II to try and understand who could do withstand the kind of pressures of being behind enemy lines and who couldn't. And so the OSS put together this book, Assessment of Men, to share the beginnings of the discipline of psychological profiling, psychometric testing, and so on. And then you come all the way up to the more present day, which is this tool called Mosaic, which is run by a company called Experian, and they know pretty much everything about every consumer in the UK for credit scoring and so on. And they built this tool called Mosaic, and as you see, there's a USA version of it and so on. And then we looked into all the scientific research and came across this endless trove of psychometric tests. You may not be able to read these here, but the one on the left is the Cognitive Failures Questionnaire, which is things like where you slightly get things wrong or screw up. And then the one on the right is the Sexual Inhibition and Sexual Excitation Scales. And so there are many hundreds of these, and each one has, as you can see there, a kind of list of questions, and you mark yourself on the scale, and from that, some conclusion can be drawn about your psychological makeup. And it occurred to us in the moment of research, oh, look, this is a question, and how you answer it actually has scientific weight in terms of setting up a psychological profile. And so we decided in Karen to set up set it up so that every single thing that Karen ever asks you is more or less, almost everyone, is culled from one of these psychological profiles. And so therefore we are able to build a database in the background where we are able to move you, to position you on a scale and tailor the story accordingly. So I'll just show a little bit of this, of one episode. This is about 4 days in, something like that. So she's getting quite relaxed by now. And this is where you catch her unawares. The call just pops up.
Oh, all right, my treasure. That's a nice surprise. Me and Dave go way back. I've let him move in for a while. Fool. Oh, well, I've got you here. I had something in mind I wanted to try with you. Which of these would you pick? Ah, creative type, huh? People who pick the camera often prefer to work alone, framing the world, but staying out of sight. That was the first digital camera I ever owned. I used to take promo shots for Dave's band when he was in the sixth form. I used to have to buy him drinks because they wouldn't serve him at the bar. Right, I've got to go out. I've got to go to the storage unit and pick up the rest of my things. Okay, before I go though, I've got another question. Have you got a significant other?
So you can see that this interweaving all the time of the story where you're gradually learning about her and her divorce and that the fact she's now moved in with some old flame of hers called Dave, and her asking questions of you and gradually extracting things from you, and everything that seems completely incidental and throwaway in the first few days is fed back to you later on as the story kind of reaches its climax. So, you know, it's the classic internet thing where what seems like a casual and relatively relaxed thing gradually grows a bit more serious and a little less fun as it goes on, and, you know, understandably, perhaps it has a slightly dark ending. All right. So I'm going to talk about one more piece of work.
Mine's not Dave, if that's what you're thinking. Okay, take care. I'm off out. Later.
Typical Karen, always interrupting. So, you know, I'm going to talk about one more piece of work. From last year, I thought it would be really nice just to talk in a little bit more depth about one project. And this work, 2097, We Made Ourselves Over, is right in the forefront of my mind. It's the biggest work we've ever made, and it really reflects perhaps another shift in the work that we've made together. As you see there, it's commissioned by Hull City of Culture, which is which was the UK City of Culture last year, and Aarhus, Capital of Culture, which was the EU Capital of Culture. So Hull and Aarhus wanted to work together, and they kindly commissioned us to make this piece of work. In light of some of the political events of 2016, which was a bleak period in lots of ways politically, and if you come from the UK, even more so. Obviously, we voted to leave the European Union that year. We all know that Donald Trump got elected that year, and we've subsequently had a general election, which has been worse than useless. And so it seemed like it might be a good moment where progressive values were being under assault slightly, to look quite a long way ahead and to try and articulate possibilities for the future. And with the opportunity of this commission from two cities, we were like, could we create something where two entire cities imagine their future and we help articulate that imagination? Could we do something on that sort of scale? And that is what we set out to try and do, which is to create a science fiction work. And the very first invitation that started the project, when Hull City of Culture approached us, is they said, we have got access to all 300 phone boxes in Hull, and we can give them to you to do with what you want. And this is one of the cream phone boxes there. Hull is the only place in the UK that has cream phone boxes, because it has its own phone system. It never joined up with the national monopoly, British Telecom. They have their own system run by a separate company. And the phone boxes are everywhere, all across the city. And so, you know, obviously phone boxes have a great and noble place in sci-fi tradition, from Superman to The Matrix and beyond. We were like, that's so cool, we can definitely use that. And we started from the idea of like, could we get something where the phone boxes ring across the whole city at one moment, and it means something to everyone in the city as a kind of clarion call. And so the work has a number of different pieces. It has some sci-fi films, a smartphone app, pop-up screenings, and live events, all of which are designed to engage people in a conversation and then give form to that conversation in such a way that we were reflecting back, not just what people had told us, we were engaging with the ideas that came from people and creating something, creating an artwork out of that. So the first thing we did was begin a series of interviews with experts in Hull and Aarhus, and make short films about their view of the future. And some of them were kind of neat, contained, properly scientific thinking about the future. We spoke to experts on climate change. We said, right, well, how are these two cities going to be different in 2097? And we chose 2097 for a very particular reason. It's obviously 80 years from last year. And it's an interesting time span in that most of us in this room might not be around in 2097, but there are plenty of people already walking around who will be around in 2097. So it is within a human lifespan, and yet it's far enough ahead for us that we can't just extrapolate from the present and just sort of draw straight lines to say what will happen. It gives us a little bit of freedom to imagine and to play, and yet we can also be aware that our children and our grandchildren will experience this. And looking back 80 years to 1937, it's one of those weird things where that feels like a long time ago in certain ways, and yet if you walk through, well, I guess Singapore would look remarkably different. In the UK, most places would look remarkably similar from 80 years ago. We haven't changed that much. So it's an interesting time frame, and in a way, perhaps the contrast between Singapore and the UK is exactly on point, which is things might change a little or they might change a lot. It depends where you're standing as those 80 years elapse. And then we went and worked with schools and did workshops with young kids and took them through a process of imagining how the future might look. And we then worked with 15 young people in each city, and we did an exchange where we took 5 young people from Hull to Aarhus to meet people from Aarhus, 5 people who had never been abroad before, gave them the opportunity to meet people from a different place. And we worked with the over 60s and invited them to give us their thoughts. And we got some really surprising ideas came out. One of the things that came out was in Hull in particular, but in Aarhus also, huge housing estates were built in the 1950s, 60s and 70s, modernist Le Corbusier style housing estates. The one in Aarhus is legendary because it's one of the largest in Europe. And these, of course, are seen as failed experiments, disastrous things. Many of them are being knocked down and rebuilt in different ways. But when we spoke to people over the age of 60 in Hull, quite a lot of them still had really positive things to say about it. And yes, they knew that crime had been bad in some of those estates. And yes, they knew that sometimes the architecture had been put together cheaply and the quality wasn't good. But they also talked about a vision for the future and about how it was about new communities coming together and how they were built with much more green space around them than there had ever been before, and so on. So that really surprised us from people who had lived on those estates. They had a different perspective. And we did exercises like this where we're asking people to think about who decides the future, to explore people's idea of agency and autonomy. And this is a really nice drawing that someone called Sophie drew in Aarhus. And she's written there, machines do all the work. As people can live wherever they want to, cities are disappearing. And this is an example of the kind of outcome of a workshop where we took that and we were like, that's fantastic. Let's do something with that idea. And there were others, the idea that you could download your brain onto a computer. We were like, okay, great. Let's try and explore that. And we also used this as an opportunity to kind of think aspirationally about where we might want the future to be, to set up sort of chains of association, and to do some processes where we worked through the future in 20-year chunks and invited people to position their idea on this timeline to think about how things might change over time. And based on all that work, we then went away and wrote 5 scripts for 5 short science fiction films, and we then shot those films in Hull and in Aarhus, and we created a new fictional city called Aarhus, in which these two cities were combined through some magical process that I won't go into. And all the time, those films were made with the participation of local people. This is just one day, one group of extras who were in one of the scenes. But the actors themselves came from Hull and Aarhus. We worked with dozens of volunteers who helped us do the filming. We were out in public spaces doing the filming, so the films themselves, the actual act of filming, was a great opportunity to bring people to us and to engage with them about what the work was doing. And we worked with a really talented VFX artist, special effects artist, to create some beautiful scenes of future possibilities. And I realize now that the little bit I'm going to show you has no special effects in it at all. Sorry about that. But I thought this would be a nice little excerpt just to kind of give you a flavor of from one of the films. This is actually from the 5th film. All the films take place in 2097. and they all follow the history of a group of three girls led by a girl called Hessa. And in 2097, the city is ruled by teenage girls. About the age of 12 or 13, you become eligible to rule, and around the age of 15 or 16, you step down. And the idea is that these are people who are not corrupt, they have no axe to grind, they have clarity, they have idealism, they have ideas, they are the right people to be given control of the city. And in film one, we meet Hessa at a funeral, as someone who is older than her has died and bequeathed her consciousness to Hessa, and Hessa takes control of this consciousness, and she and her two fellow rulers make the decision to completely destroy the city and rebuild it on a new site across the marshes, because they look back through history and they realize that all attempts at dealing with inequality have failed. And they decide, right, we're going to do this properly once and for all. We're going to rebuild the city from scratch. And the film really sort of tells the story of them coming to understand what might be some of the limitations of that approach. And in this clip that I'm going to show you now, the first area of the city has been destroyed, and Hessa's mother and her two neighbors are journeying through the marshes, and Hessa is with them filming them. And you'll notice that because of the very icy looks that the characters are giving to the camera every now and then is because Hessa is holding the camera. Carrying these boxes because that's all they were permitted to take as they left the old city.
I still can't believe she made us go first.
It was all three of them. And besides, it proves the system. She chose her mother's district.
These days you'll realize why this is so hard for us.
So we're going to stop it there. So all the films are very short, and all of them have very little dialogue, and that's for a very particular reason, which is that it was our intention right from the get-go that the films would be screened all around Hull on this mobile screen. And we spent weeks visiting every corner of the city to screen these films in places where people might just be passing with their shopping, and the film is short enough that they could stand with their shopping in their hands and watch one before deciding whether they would take a sit down and watch the rest or head on their way for home. So one of the great things about a city of culture type experience is it's a moment where everyone in the city is aware that something is going on culturally, and you have this fantastic moment of attention to be able to play with. So it was really important to us that we took the films out to people and that they would stumble on them. You don't have to be culturally interested. The film would come to you. And that included us screening them at halftime during a game for the English Premier League when Hull were playing at home last season. So we did that. And then, as I mentioned, on the 1st of October at 2 p.m., every single phone box in the whole of Hull rang. And we were astonished that every single phone box had a queue of people outside it waiting for the call. And Hesse was ringing from the future and asking for your help. And you interacted using the keypad on the phone. And then some people would be lucky enough to be told that there was a visitor from the future nearby who was going to come and pick them up. And you would then get invited to take a trip in this Tesla. And in the back of the car was one of the some of the characters from the film, and so you meet people who've been in the film, and people told us over and over again how important and powerful it was to them to see their own city represented in the film, in the films, to hear the accents of Hull and Aarhus on film, and to then meet those people, That was our kind of live event in Hull, and then we did something matching in Aarhus a couple of weeks later, where we took over this deserted velodrome, and you learn that the velodrome is the place where Hesse, Catrius, and Vidia, the three girls, had made the decision to destroy the city, and so this site has been preserved for history now, and you get the chance to visit the velodrome and explore it. And it starts with you getting into a car in the center of Aarhus and being driven at night out to, you don't know where you're going, you have no idea where you're going, and you arrive into a concrete tunnel where you're given a pair of headphones and an overcoat to wear and a mobile device, and you walk through this bright light tunnel filled with smoke, and you emerge out where you can see the smoke coming out behind this person's head. You come up out of this hole into the middle of this deserted velodrome, and using a location-based app, you can explore the site, and you hear from Hesse, you gradually learn how the story was put together. And that work culminates with a similar experience to the one in the back of the car, where you're invited to think about someone close to you, to think about what change could come into their life, and to then think about how you might help bring that change about. And all of the science fiction wing-wang suddenly comes very narrowly down into focus about you, someone you care for, and what change you could make for them in your life. And we had quite a lot of people in tears through that process, because it becomes a sudden, very precise moment of reflection about how you might create change right now rather than a change that exists some way out into the future. And then just to finish, the last part of that is the app, which is still in the App Store, and this is the first screen you see, and it turns out that the funeral we see in film one is actually you, and you have died, and Hesse now is going to talk to you and your consciousness about what life has been like through the 21st century. She's only 15. She doesn't know anything of what happened in the 2020s or 30s or 40s or 50s, and she asks you to fill her in on what has happened in the world. You explore the future and your own ideas. There you go. You see a little bit of the special effects there that Matt made for us. And you meet not just Hesse, but here Catrius on the left and Vidia on the right. And so you, again, in liking Karen, you're engaging these kind of conversations backwards and forwards. Unliking Karen, it's not stalking you and freaking you out. It's really inviting you to think about the future. So, you know, I started off by saying that interactive means unfinished, And I hope that in all of the works that I've talked to you, that you see that the critical thing is about what that aperture is that opens the work towards you, the public, and invites you into a conversation where the work does not necessarily proselytize for a particular point of view or a particular idea. It invites you to articulate ideas. We try and give you space where you might be able to think in a way that you might not normally have a chance to think. You might have a moment to reflect or a space to reflect in a way that you might not normally be able to. And then an opportunity to articulate something in response to that. That in the act of you taking that step of putting yourself forwards, it might be in a very small way in Can You See Me Now, or it might be in a very prolonged and sustained way in Karen or in We Made Ourselves Over. But in whatever the level of experience we're offering you, we're trying to give you that moment where the act of you making an utterance is bringing something out of you that perhaps you would not have otherwise thought about or spoken about or spoken in that way or given form to in that way. So that interactivity is not just about things being unfinished, it's about your agency. It's about where control sits and how we open control to one another. And that, of course, is ultimately a political question, both a small p and a large p political question. But if we have learned anything through the last couple of weeks about Cambridge Analytica and the Facebook data thing, if we've learned anything over the last couple of years about some of the largest events going on in public life, it is that technology has profound political ramifications for how we go through the world, and we're very much focused on trying to find different ways, different engaging ways to answer that question. Thanks very much. So I'd be really happy to answer any questions if you have some. Yes.
Hi, my name's Philip. And we recently, my friend and I started a company around customer data strategy. So what we always say is that if you use data responsibly in a way that benefits your customers, that's better business for companies as well. Now, when I look at Karen, I can clearly see the value to myself because I'm engaging in this and I can probably learn something about myself. But obviously the data that's collected on the back of that is very sensitive. Mm-hmm. And I often find that it's very easy to design a tempting experience where users will be giving a lot of their data and maybe not even be aware of what that means. But where do you stand in terms of when does it get unethical? Like where do you stand on that spectrum? As in what's fine and what's not, and how should we be approaching those boundaries?
So I don't think there's an absolute answer to that question. I think it is very contextual, because the question is what do I understand that you're doing with my data? To what extent am I aware of what's going on? So that, you know, what's egregious in terms of all of the large tech companies is not that they're gathering large amounts of data. It's that they very deliberately are obscuring what is happening to it and how it might be being used. So I don't think there's a direct ethical boundary there. In terms of Karen, you know, obviously, when we came to write our data policy, we were pretty alert to those questions, and we ultimately took the decision to anonymize the data immediately and destroy the data after 6 months. And in some ways, that's quite painful, because we work with researchers who would love to be able to use some of that data, but that, you know, that's clearly a question of how we could be explicit about it. One thing I didn't mention is that business model is not a phrase that crops up that often in the work we make. We're not great at business models, but there is one in Karen to some extent, which is that when you finish the experience, which takes about 10 days, you're then offered the opportunity to buy your data report. And this was authored by Dr. Kelly Page, one of the researchers we worked with. And if you buy that, and it's about £3, depending on what territory you're in, to buy it, that shows you what you did through the experience, and so all the choices that you made. It shows what impact that had on the story that you had, and then it shows the underlying science, which forms of psychometric tests we were using with that question, and where that question came, which test that question came from. So it's a question of trying to make that as explicit as possible. Oh, hi, sorry.
Gunmetal 3, and then looking at the Day of the Figurines, and then looking at Karen and so on, there is a passage from, say, that very visceral liveness to the mediatized.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, there are kind of the limits that you're working with have very much to do with death, with decay, and with disappearance. So I'm wondering whether you're thinking of things like implants or microchips or cryogenics. And it's not really the sort of, it's not really the technology I'm interested in, but more the kind of conceptualization of being and not being, or absence and presence, life and death, and so on.
I can see the trend that you're talking about there. Although to me, it's much more of a kind of flickering needle backwards and forwards, and that the aspect of liveness is so critical to almost every piece of work we've ever made. So even Karen and the app for 2097 we made ourselves over, which are pure digital objects available in your app store, folks. And that was a big question for us. Can we make something that still feels authentically like a piece of our work, in which it is a standalone digital object? Even in those works, I think of them performatively. I think of them being about a particular moment in your day when you're going to get that. And that's why the episodes in Karen, at one point she rings at 12:30 at night and she sends you notification alerts that say, "Darling, it's me, where are you?" and things like that. And I've met many people who've said that they've had to explain to their partner why they're suddenly getting messages from someone called Karen that their partner has noticed at 1 a.m. this flashing while the user of the app is actually asleep. But it's precisely the fact that she's annoying enough that she'll ring you at 12:30 at night or 1 a.m. that gives it that performative thing. I know that I'm probably going to disturb your sleep, or at the very least appear when you least expect it, and that she's demanding your attention at that moment. So we return to that liveness, and in my kind of wrap up, I talked about the political questions around interactivity. Well, of course, liveness is one of the precise moments where that is at its height. One of the things that's distinctive about the UK is that we had censorship of theatre until the late 1960s, and that was because theatre was seen as a highly risky medium, and there had been riots, even at the Royal Opera House in the 19th century, there were riots. So there is an inherent instability and thrill around live interaction that I never would want to say goodbye to. So in terms of where we're thinking in the future, I mean, at the moment we're doing a project we're artists in residence at the World Health Organization, and we're making two exhibitions, one in New York and one in Hong Kong, about contagion and cities. And so we're really looking at the particular issues around sort of pandemics, and then at the same time reflecting that back to the flu pandemic of 1918. Which, if any of you are not aware of it, is where 50 million people died worldwide from a flu pandemic through 1918 and 1919, far more than died in World War I, and is almost certainly the most fatal outbreak of disease yet to hit the human race, and yet is not that particularly well known. So we're doing that project, and then we're doing a number of live cinema projects, starting with a work this autumn about conscientious objectors, And again, looking at the idea of the cinema being a kind of the cinema being interactive, and so the film is shot and streamed in real time. It's a single shot film, and as you sit down in the cinema, we are stood in on location with the crew, and the film happens in real time, and you interact on your mobile phone during the film, and the characters on screen are aware of that. So. Not so much about the microchips or the cryogenics.
Yeah, so it's more about relationality.
I suppose so, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Hi.
Hello.
Thank you so much for sharing. I have two questions that might actually be one question. A lot of the works, because they're interactive, involve engaging so many other people. So my first question would be, how do you engage and mobilize that many people? And the second question would be, in engaging and involving so many people, how do all of you maintain a certain level of quality of the work? Because it could be very likely that, you know, what if the person doesn't want to respond accordingly, and that will, or maybe because they know that they're in a game, they don't behave or don't adhere to the rules of your game. How do you deal with that?
Yeah, I think that's two very different questions, so I'll happily talk about both of them. So, the first answer is often surprisingly small numbers of people are involved, so that makes it easier, especially in those earlier works. So even when they're works online, you know, they're typically only a few hundred people involved. So. That's a pragmatic kind of consideration in terms of how we make our work, in terms of how well we're able to share that. But it is possible to scale those projects almost infinitely in some cases. It's just a question of resources. So I mentioned that we did work for Channel 4, and they said, it has to be able to scale to 250,000 users. And actually, we then architected the whole piece of work to be able to get to that number. And even so, we didn't make something that was completely standalone. It still had human interaction within it. But we built software that would be able to manage how humans could interact with 250,000 simultaneous users. So it's definitely possible to do. It is a question of sort of thinking about that carefully at the outset, I suppose. And the second question, in terms of sort of how people act. Yeah, so I mean, the first thing is, of course, any game, people try and break it immediately. And some people take delight in trolling other people, or I think griefing is the correct term, you know, which is to ruin other people's experience. In Uncle Royal Around You, you know, there would be people who made it their business to direct the street players the wrong way, and to try and run their clock out and stuff like that. And of course, people would be furious, you know, if you've got someone online saying, no, don't go that way, turn around, go back, and they're lying. So there's a kind of multiple layers of how you kind of deal with that, how we deal with that. You know, one is, well, there's a certain level of interaction within a social environment that is the responsibility of the people within that environment. And then there's another level of it, which is absolutely our responsibility, and that often is a question of working out how to deal with people who are attempting to cheat the game, or attempting to cheat other people, or to mess with other people, but not to do that through an overly authoritarian approach, because the whole point of games is that's part and parcel of it, right? People can be really annoying when you play a board game. You don't need anything like this to let people be annoying. They've got the ability to do it right from the get-go. So part of that is about like trying to navigate that as best we can. Like an example once is that we had someone who logged onto the game with the username ArabFag, and so we're now going, okay, is that an act of homophobic abuse? Is that an act of anti-Arabic sentiment? Or is that a permissible, extremely risque name for a user within our game? and we ultimately decided to do nothing about that. And we subsequently found out that that is someone who is both Arabic and gay, and that is their username that they like to go by. So if you're on Grindr, do search for Arab fag. I'm sure it will come up. So, you know, that's an example of where you've got to be really careful, because all of us, our immediate response is that person needs kicking from the game, right? That you can't let that go on. And luckily, we kind of talked our way just around it. So a lot of that is, it's about specific decision making at the time. But then I think there's a deeper part to your question, which is just how do you make interactive experiences for the full range of human experience? And you know, games culture is a good reference point here, in that there are people out there who have been playing games 6 hours a day for the last 30 years, and they know every aspect of everything about games, and they are passionately devoted to every minute detail of how games work. And then there are people who have not played games before, and when we're creating these experiences, you're trying to deal with both of those audiences. And of course, you're getting a disproportionate amount of the real fan girls and boys coming, because they're interested in what's happening in new game experiences. So you're getting a high proportion of people who are very, very experienced, and then a decent slug of people for whom this is the first time they've ever dipped their toe in that water. That's not always something that we can do, but in some of our experiences, we have had 8 layers of knowledge giving or help providing structures in place to try and help people move through that, to give from before the game finishes right the way through until after the game ends, to be able to give all of those layers of support. And we also try very hard to have a game that does not favor the most confident, the loudest, the most extrovert. We really try and think about our experiences being for people with all tones of voice and all kinds of forms of expression, and try and look for how we accommodate that. And I guess we do that better sometimes than at others, but it's still something that we go through, you know, checking ourselves against very carefully. You know, we don't want to have experiences like so many online experiences, which is sort of brassy, shouty people dominate, and the sort of discourse aggregates around what they like to talk about and how they like to talk. Hello. Have you got the? Can you bring the mic down here? This lady's in the third row from the front.
Okay, hello, thanks for being here very much. The collective, you know, the work and all that, it resides in the interstices of the definitions and functions of art and its relationship with society. How then do you reside in this kind of like interstice where people are always trying to label you, oh, they are performance art, they're not really performance art, they are like game developers, they're not really game developers, they are live art people. And obviously from, you know, councils to art councils to audiences are obviously trying to put, you know, like labels on your group. And, and how then do you deal with that labeling? Basically, my question is, how do you have a conversation with someone who is perhaps intent on going another direction with that conversation? And as an artist, how do you deal with that?
Yeah, I mean, it is a real issue. And, you know, we have a board of trustees, and our board of trustees are often like, I'm not quite sure how to explain you in one sentence. And, you know, I guess over time, we've gradually grown more relaxed with the, it's quite hard, you know. So, you know, we say we make interactive art. That's the 4-word summation. And then once you go beyond that, then it becomes, it's an opportunity for a very interesting set of dialogues, because we didn't really think of ourselves as game designers when we were making Desert Rain and Can You See Me Now? And then suddenly we realized, oh God, we are, that's what we've been doing. And when we first started to show work in the United States, we suddenly found that there was a whole community of people who were really aware of all of our work, and they had been following it, and they were all indie games designers. And so they had seen something in our work that we hadn't really particularly articulated. I mean, I think, you know, the great thing about where we are culturally at the moment is that there is an incredible fluidity, and the people are generally fairly relaxed about those categorizations. And I feel incredibly privileged to be able to make installation work. I haven't shown any work made for galleries, but we did a work specifically for galleries last year. So, that kind of liminal intersection of all of those different categories, each one of those is an interesting an uncertain place to be in. You know, I talked about in Desert Rain about how it starts as a game. It's quite hokey, you know, if you think about it, that beginning. Like, you are going on a mission, you are player six, you need to find Shona, all of that sort of stuff. It's like, that's a really very familiar kind of gamey setup. And then you go into your virtual world and you're exploring around and you're chatting and, you know, you hear that guy in the film say, has anyone acquired yet? And all of that, you know, you get into the kind of game-ish language. And then suddenly, you go over the sand and you drop into that hotel room, and it's like this, you know, you don't hear it you didn't hear it today in that little clip, but Glenn was picking up Iraqi casualties and he's talking about what a tracer wound does to the human flesh and how you can look and see the concentric rings as it's burnt its way into the flesh. And so you move from gamey, we've only got 3 minutes left, everyone get out, to a sudden thing where you're stood in that hotel room. Some of my favorite groups, whoever came to Desert Rain, incidentally, would be groups of sort of 13-year-olds or 14-year-olds who'd been brought by their mum as a birthday present, and it'd be like, oh yeah, darling, you love games. I'm bringing you and five friends. You're gonna play this virtual reality game. You're gonna really enjoy it. And then there would be six slightly ashen-faced teenagers appearing emerging at the end with a new perspective on virtual warfare. But you know, that's exactly where the false categorization is absolutely at its best. You know, to me, that's everything that I'm after, is that moment where people who are deeply impressionable are brought into an environment where they have a good time. It's not like they've been forced to sit through some sort of minimalist opera and they've been chewing their knuckles throughout. It's like they've had fun, but they have also been taken somewhere where they really weren't expecting it. So I think there's always a possibility there.
Thank you. One last question for me.
I think we only have time for one last question, and I think it's only fair to let this lady take it.
Thank you very much for your talk and showing us all those interesting artworks.
Sorry. Hello. Right, two more questions then, because I know you have been patiently waiting. Yes, please.
So I guess I find your artworks are often associated with the cutting edge or new technology at the time. And I think in a way that, in one way technology enabled your artwork, but on the other hand, it might also constrain the format, the way you express yourself. Mm-hmm. So I guess my question is, are you interested in exploring interaction without technology element, and is there anything that you have in your mind that you really want to explore, but currently you can't because of the constraint of technology?
The interaction without technology is the one that you and I are having right now, and that is in our work very often, right? It's a conversation between one person and another person. You know, a big influence on me when I was first interested in theatre is the book by Peter Brook, The Empty Stage. And Peter Brook was a famous theatre director of the 60s, 70s and 80s in England. And he talks about the essence of theatre is one person in a place at a time being watched by one other person. You know, that is it. An actor and a viewer in a particular place at a particular time, and you have a theatrical moment. And what technology has done is proliferate all the ways in which, all the spaces in which those four elements are present. They are present in a virtual space as much as they're present in on a stage like the one that we're stood on today. So, I think the thing about constraints, I mean, all material has constraints. If you're working in oil paint, you have constraints. That's a good thing. It's a discipline. It's productive, I think. So, there have been times where we've been dreaming of what might yet be to come. But really, in the last few years, I don't think that any of the three of us are that worried by that. I think we're much more interested in how we can use the tools, as these tools have moved from technological innovation through to social innovation, through to social norms, and now embedded social actions in terms of who gets elected. To me, to be right at the forefront of still looking ahead at the next technological innovation seems slightly less relevant. To me, it seems much more important to work with the technologies we've got and the circumstances we've got to try and address that. I think that's the way that we're thinking about it. So yes, this lady down here, and this will be the last question.
Yeah, thanks for the fascinating presentation. So my question is actually sort of leading on off of the second to the last one. So with traditional theater that maintains the fourth wall, with film, with games, even up to 3D interactive games that are, however, played out on a monitor, you've got a certain level of abstraction and distance, and people talk about how that enables you to go through experiences you wouldn't want to go through in real life, and enables a certain type of catharsis that you also might not happen if you did those experiences in real life. So your work is very much involved with crossing that boundary, destroying the fourth wall, involving people in live interactions, and then of course the most recent variant of VR with 3D stereo also really destroys that fourth wall in a certain type of way, because people don't really sit there and say, well, I can actually close my eyes and it'll all go away. They tend to really get involved in it. So
yep.
A lot of your, a number of your pieces could really potentially traumatize people. Do you, so to speak, plan for that eventuality? How do you deal with people who have been involved in your pieces who are traumatized? Or do you just say, like, hope you had fun? Bye? Or do you, do you watch them and look for them and think, okay, is this person really going to go home and, like, have a complete breakdown and try and walk them back out of that? How do you deal with that?
Yeah, so, I mean, you're right that there is an ethical sort of factor in everything that we do, a really profound set of ethical concerns run through all of the works that we're making, and we take that really seriously, and in fact we've hosted a 3-day long seminar on ethics at our studio with experts in ethics to try and explore this question in relation to this work, this kind of work. There are many other people working in this field now, and many of us are all wrestling with similar sets of questions. I mean, just by the by, it's worth mentioning that the concept of safe spaces and trigger word is something that I don't hold with. And I think that has to be treated with incredible care. Those ideas, I can understand that they come from a very well-intentioned place. But once we run into public discourse being determined by the feelings of someone else, I think we're into a very dangerous set of territory. And I'm aware that that's a problematic position. It's probably not an argument, a discussion that we can wrap up in 2 minutes right now. But we are currently doing a piece of work, and we will show at the South Bank Centre in London next February this work again called Operation Black Antler. And in that work, we invite every single audience member to adopt a secret identity and to infiltrate a far-right meeting and to engage people who are fiercely xenophobic, anti-immigrant, in conversation to try and get information from them and then pass that back to the police. So you can imagine that is, you're really pushing a lot of buttons, and that's a game that is very different to play depending on what the color of your skin is, what gender you are, what your cultural background is. So, that's a prime example where we're working really, really hard to think carefully about all of the minute details of how that experience is constructed, And so, for example, just as a kind of lens on that, we decided very early on that the far right people you meet are not racist. They're anti-immigrant, but not racist. And that's a very, very important difference, because it helps us deal with the ethical concern of what is this like for someone who is of a different cultural background than white British, and how are they going to respond to the idea that they are playing with that. Having said that, the risk is up here, but I also think the reward is up here. Because what we also do is put lots of liberal art goers into a situation where they have to pretend to be interested in the views of a far right person and listen to what that person says to them and agree with them outwardly as part of their information gathering experience. And people come out really fascinated by that process of having listened to someone who complains about immigrants in a, you know, who has a particular perspective on why they don't like immigrants. Not just blind hatred, but they have a clear set of arguments and rationales for why they are firmly anti-immigrant, and you have to go through that. So art, if it's to be anything, is a place where you can play a little bit at being at those different perspectives and taking on those different subjective positions. And you know, in Operation Black Antler, you can walk out at any moment, and you can walk out of a conversation at any moment. And guess what? The really scary far-right people who you're meeting are all trained actors who are incredibly carefully looking after you while they are looking really scary and aggressive. And so they are well-trained at picking up any sign that this is going too far or starting to stray into dangerous territory, and they are accommodating that all of the time. And we're having an hour-long team meeting every single day that show is running to review one by one feedback about particular audience experiences. So, you know, I think it's about walking a line, using really careful judgment, but also being quite brave about that. And I have to say that when Operation Black Antler was first announced, there was a major social media storm against the work. Many dozens of people wrote saying the work should be banned, and that they wrote to the people who were commissioning it and said it should not go ahead. This is a game that no one should be playing. And we, you know, for 6 weeks we went into complete lockdown. We took advice from security experts, the whole works, because we really thought that people were going to come and smash up the show on the opening night. So you know, the stakes are you know, it's not just a game. And so, you know, this is one of the interesting things in games culture, isn't it? Is that to the wider, wider people, games are considered to be fun, playful, silly little things. But any of us who are more interested in games and looking at games culture know that there are many, many fascinating examples of complex games posing really difficult problems about society, which is exactly as it should be. Sorry, I went into a little rant there. Thanks so much for your question. It's really interesting. And I'd be delighted to talk to any of you afterwards. I'll be hanging around, so please do come and say hello. As I put up there, there's our website, and the two apps I mentioned are still in the App Store. Thanks so much for coming tonight.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm sure you've enjoyed this very insightful lecture. I would now like to invite Professor Steve Dixon, President of LaSalle College of the Arts, to present a token of appreciation to Mr. Matt Adams. Professor Dixon, please. Welcome. This painting, titled Mapping Melancholia, is a special artwork by Moses Tan, a graduate of LaSalle, who obtained his Bachelor's in Fine Arts with honors in 2016. Thank you, Professor Dixon. With that, we have come to the end of this evening's program. Please join me in giving another warm round of applause to Mr. Matt Adams. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for attending tonight's public lecture series. Please enjoy the food that has been prepared for you at the foyer outside. I look forward to seeing you again soon. Until then, good night.